Bismillahirrahmanirrahim. Assalamu alaikum. Our today's short story is one that you people have also studied in your compulsory English course. It is a famous short story, Araby, by James Joyce. James Joyce was born on 2nd February 1882 in Dublin, Ireland. He was an Irish novelist, short story writer, poet, teacher, and literary critic. He contributed to modernist movement and is regarded as one of the most influential and important writers of the 20th century. His notable works include some novels, Ulysses, A Portrait of the Artist as a Young Man, Finnegan's Wake, and a collection of short stories, Dubliners. The present short story, Araby, was included in this collection. He is one of the pioneers of the stream of consciousness technique in literature. He died on 13th January 1941 in Switzerland. As far as the characters of the story are concerned, first we have an unnamed boy. This boy is the protagonist of the story. He is about 12 years old. He is on the verge of his adolescence. The story has been narrated in the first person, and we look at all other characters and events through the eyes of this boy. Then there is Mangan. He is playmate of our hero. He also lives in the same street. Mangan's sister. She is an unnamed girl who becomes the center of attention for the boy. Aunt and uncle. The boy lives with his aunt and uncle. The writer does not give any clue about his parents, and the reader assumes that the boy perhaps is an orphan. The relationship of the boy with his aunt and uncle is apparently not very close and loving. The incidents of the story take place first at North Richmond Street. This is the place where the boy lives with his aunt and uncle, and then at Araby. It's a temporary bazaar from where the boy wants to buy something special for Mangan's sister. The story takes its title from a real festival which came to Dublin in 1894 when Joyce was himself 12 years old. The boy lives in North Richmond Street. His house is situated at the blind end of the street. The setting is quite drab from the very beginning. Before them, a priest lived in that house and he died here. No element of gaiety or cheerfulness can be traced in the boy's description of the house. He mentions some books of the priest that he has found in there and has read them. A lone apple tree is situated in the garden. In the winter, the boy plays in and around the street with his friends. On arrival of his uncle, the children hide in the dark. When Mangan's sister comes to her doorstep to call her brother back to home, they first wait for her to leave and then come to the doorstep. Here, for the first time, we notice how minutely the boy observes the elder sister of his friend. He states, "She was waiting for us, her figure defined by the light from the half-opened door. Her dress swung as he moved her body, and the soft rope of her hair tossed from side to side. New passions are awakening inside him to which he has been unaware up till now. Leaving his childhood behind, he is now stepping on the threshold of adolescence. This period of transition or change from one phase to another is very important in every person's life. Every day, the boy waits in the front room of his house for the girl to leave her house. As soon as she steps out into the street, he picks up his books and follows her hastily. They rarely exchange any words. The boy is frustrated as he becomes more and more obsessed by the thoughts of the girl. The image of the girl stays with him continuously. He says, "Her name was like summons to all my foolish blood." And at another occasion, "Her name sprang to my lips at moments in strange prayers." He describes his frustrated situation in these words: "I did not know whether I would speak to her or not, or if I spoke to her, how I could tell her of my confused adoration. But my body was like a harp, and her words and gestures were like fingers running upon the wires." He recalls that one rainy evening he took refuge in the back drawing room and in the dark kept calling, "Oh love, oh love," in a frenzy. In his confusion of this overwhelming passion, he is unable to talk to her, let alone express his feelings. One day the girl herself initiates the conversation while other boys are still playing. She asks him if he has visited Araby and tells him that she cannot go as there is a religious ritual of retreat at her convent. This is ironical, as the reader can clearly see that the girl is moving forward on the path of God. She is going to spend some time in seclusion to strengthen her spiritual relation with God. But the boy is unable to see this, and we feel that James Joyce has made a figurative use of the words like blind and dark. Not only the street where the boy lives is blind, but the boy himself is blind to the stark realities. The boy promises to bring something for her from the bazaar, Araby, which appeared so romantic to him. On this occasion, we get another detailed description of the girl and get a chance of looking at her from the boy's perspective. The light from the lamp opposite our door caught the white curve of her neck, lit up her hair that rested there, and falling, lit up the hand upon the railing. And then starts a seemingly never-ending period of wait for the boy. He can only visit the bazaar on weekend. Time moves slowly for him. All through this period, he is constantly haunted by the image of the girl, and he has to struggle hard to concentrate on his work at school. The word Araby appears so magical to him. He seeks his aunt's permission and remains absent-minded at school. On Saturday morning, he reminds his uncle of his visit to Araby, but the uncle takes the matter very casually. He returns from school. His endless wait continues. He does not join his playmates in the street. He goes in isolation in the upper part of the house. He also has to endure the visit of an old neighbor. His uncle returns very late that night and finally gives him money, a florin, to go to Araby. The boy reaches the particular place very late on a special train. In his fear of losing more time, he gets a comparatively costly entrance to the bazaar, which the boy finds almost closed at that late hour of night. He states, "Nearly all the stalls were closed, and the greater part of the hall was in darkness." The boy, who has come here in the height of expectations, with deep romantic notions to buy first precious gift for his first love, now finds himself in a state of utter frustration and disappointment. Time and money are not in his favor. His shattered state of mind can be seen when he says, remembering with difficulty why I had come. All his hopes are dashed, and for the first time he comes face to face with the bitter realities of life. In his own words, "I knew my stay was useless. I allowed the 2 pennies to fall against the 6 pence in my pocket." The concluding lines of the story are so pathetic and make the reader realize that boy has learned his lesson in a bitter way. "Gazing up into the darkness, I saw myself as a creature derived and driven by vanity, and my eyes burned with anguish and anger." James Joyce has written a coming-of-age story and very beautifully portrayed the inner feelings of an adolescent boy who is getting introduced to the passions of love. His infatuation takes him on a painful journey of disillusionment that serves as major theme in the story. T.S. Eliot once said, "The world was made for Joyce's convenience," meaning that Joyce didn't have to invent symbols. And they were lying about the streets of Dublin, waiting for him to pick them up. The use of word blind in the story is an indication of boy's limited vision of life and his blindness to reality. The word brown also occurs in with symbolic impact and describes the dullness and dreariness of lives of Dubliners. The images of darkness and light also have symbolic implications of unawareness and spiritual enlightenment, respectively. Critics have also traced religious symbolism in the story. For example, the dead priest, who is the former tenant of the boy's house, is very suggestive. The solitary apple tree in the garden is reminiscent of the Garden of Eden. The use of light around the girl may imply her spiritual bent, and so on. Throughout the story, we find the boy entangled in conflict, whether internal, where the boy finds it hard to suppress his feelings of love for the girl, or the external conflict, where surrounded by adults in a world where nobody pays any heed to a young boy's feelings, and he suffers an acute mental torture. Overall, this is an amazing story that captures minute details of an important phase of the boy's life, and the reader finds him coming out of the blind alley of his romantic notions into the real world of hard realities, where incidents take their own course and so many forces are beyond human control. My dear students, this is a brief analysis of the story for you to understand and prepare for your exams. Please listen carefully, and if you have any questions, just let me know. Take care. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah.